is the hardest thing.
Bright and sunny on this 10-race Friday afternoon, May the 10th, in fact. Jason Blewett, Ron Nicoletti joining you. Little bright lights of our clubhouse studios high above the finish line. A really nice day outside, Ronnie, as we've got a kind of a multi-race wager mania going on, considering all the little gimmicks we have on the table today.
Yeah, we got this. We'll show you the menu later. We got, of course, the Rainbow Six with almost $900,000 in the pool, but we got the Stronic 5 today, too.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Ronnie and I both giving out tickets. It's for the Stronic 5, and I get there might be a couple of scratches along the way, but just to tease our tickets and, again, that lineup a bit later in the show, opening leg 12 horses, leg B 12, then you've got 10, then you've got 14, and then you got 11. I was pretty confused trying to put in a modest ticket of about $40 together.
I nailed it with $72.
Right. Take that to the bank, ladies and gentlemen. That's what that means. Now, the good news is, as we move ahead, not only here at Gulfstream, we're just 8 days out from Saturday's 144th running of the Preakness Stakes. And although we don't have that rematch we were hoping for minutes after the Kentucky Derby was made official between Maximum Security and Country House, we do have an amazing betting race. And we've got a horse trained by Bob Baffert by the name of Improbable, who unequivocally will be favored. And Bob Baffert, 7 prior Preakness wins. Think about that.
We were trying to guess yesterday. Oof. We got as high as 6, but it was 7.
7.
That's amazing. So he'll be the favorite in there. War of Will, if you go back and look at the Kentucky Derby, if that horse had some running room, things might have been different. So it's turning out, as Jason said, to be a pretty nice handicapping affair. And that is next Saturday, the Preakness Stakes 144.
Absolutely. We'll celebrate Old Hilltop, of course, this great game of ours, the greatest game played outdoors in the rich history with Maryland Racing. As far as the local situation on this Friday, May the 10th, again, a 10-pack coming down the Florida Turnpike, there are a few things worth looking forward to, beginning with the venerable Harry He in the first race. I picked against him. Ronnie's got him on top. The question is not his talent, not his heart. It's not any of that stuff. It's can he stay a demanding 7 furlongs against a good field in race number 1, a little past 1:20 p.m. How about, though, with that second tagline there, Ronnie, the recent run that trainer Mike Lerman's been on, as he's got a major player in the 8th.
Yeah, he's been winning races in bunches. He'll be in the 8th race with the Funny's Tide, and we'll see how that race plays out. And the opening honor is with the Stronic 5 is today. We usually start at Laurel, but now with Pimlico, a little different post time. We're starting right here at Gulfstream Park.
Yeah, GP has a doubleheader in today's 100K guarantee Stronic 5. And again, those opening honors are all ours here at Gulfstream with race number 9. Now, one change, or at least alter, if you will, and it's a minor one at that, but the Super High 5 with our carryover situation, because we got some schedule, as I like to say, in that Super High 5 carryover kitty, doesn't begin till race number 4. You need a minimum of 7 runners. What we really want, though, is to take down that jackpot Rainbow 6, hands down. 1 to 20 to be over $1 million today.
Oh, without a doubt. 869 plus just starting today was kissing $1 million yesterday, so I'm sure it'll be well over that. And the beauty, you can have it for a 20-cent wager.
All right, early pick 5 does begin with the first race and a very solid, likable field here. Not only Harry He, you might have a horse who was claimed at the right time for not much money by trainer Rob Falcone Jr. in Courage and Honor, and a few other hard hitters. I am 4 deep to start this out. That is at least my summation of this race. I don't fully trust Harry He going the 7. And if he just can't get it, whether it be genetics or otherwise, I mean, don't you think it opens up the race to potentially every bit of the 4, 5, and 6 getting it done?
Absolutely. And the answer, as we've been saying, does he get the 7 furlongs? He's absolutely the class of the race. That's very early in the wagering, 4 to 5 on the board. But if you beat him, you're going to get paid.
Yeah, no doubt about that. My single coming with Kathleen O'Connell's drop down in Seneva in the second race with the hot rodding Hyra Rendon. There were actually, to my surprise, and I think to yours, a number of pretty notable early/late scratches on the card, including Montaigne in the second race for Todd Pletcher. 2 deep, Three deep, two deep, a $24 play. Let's get back, though, Ronnie, in the opening leg of Friday's early five with Harry Hee and his prospects. He does get in pretty light here, and you think he's going to wire the field.
Yeah, he's dropping to the 20 starter optional claiming level, stretching out to 7/8 of a mile, and that's the kicker right there. After a trio of really strong performances going 3/4 of a mile, you got the 10-pound apprentice, Kristen Torres, trying to negotiate that added distance today, maybe the lightweight. He's never wanted 7 furlongs, and that's the unknown with this horse.
And that's what scares me a little bit with him. Again, if you're familiar or even a quasi-fan of South Florida racing during the offseason, you know how tough this horse Harry Hee is. And not a knock on him whatsoever with me having him fourth in my superfector in just a 6-horse field. But do note his one race going 7, it was in an overnight stakes, but it wasn't a good effort. Now, on the flip side, it was nearly 2 years ago here in South Florida, so a lot of time has passed. If he can't stay the trip, though, this race very much becomes a mad scramble, you would think, in the final quarter mile or so. And maybe it case, as I was saying at the top, with trainer Rob Falcone Jr. just taking a 12-5 two lifetime claiming a runner off Ken McPeak last time out. We'll show you the race some 57 days ago back in the middle of March, just a couple of weeks, in fact, 2.5 weeks out before Maximum Security in the Florida Derby. There's not a lot to see here other than a dominating effort, but I think it's noteworthy showing this, Ronnie, because the race came up unbelievably fast, and a well-pedigreed horse, maybe the light bulb, as silly as it sounds, finally went on last time out, and you know what? The new connections were there to swoop in at the right time.
Yeah, I got a 92 buyer for that effort at 12-5 level, so looks like it's going to be a really nice claim, and if Harry Hee can't get the distance, that's who I thought had the biggest chance to dethrone, we'll say, Harry Hee today. I use Just Kidding, who's been knocking on the door in consecutive races. I have the 6 a little further down the ticket than you do.
Well, yeah, a horse who is no longer Navarro, claimed out of Georgie's Barn last time out for 35 in for the 20, does get hot riding Edgar Zayas off a 3-win Thursday afternoon. Moving on to the second race, our opener this afternoon on the turf here as we start Friday's early pick 4 with a filly mare 3 and up $35,000 to $25,000 claimer. Again, the first of a number of notable defections occurs in this upcoming second with the number 2 Montaigne, and you're going to look, I would have to think, when it's all said and done, they're basically co-favored now, but the 6 Seneva is going to be favored in this race dropping down.
Yeah, dropping to this level after hitting the board in one of 2 local turf races under maiden special weight conditions. So we'll show you a stat on Kathleen O'Connell doing just that. Horses going maiden special weight to maiden claimers on the turf. She's 9/36, 25%. She's in the money 39% of the time, and she's got a really nice return of investment of $5.10. And with the scratch of that first time started at, it looked like it was a fire sale for sure. Soneva looks like the one to beat. Now you Sister Gemma in second and General June in third.
From that inside post beneath Hall of Famer Edgar Prado, who does have a chance. An easier race, you would think, theoretically, with no Montaigne in the race. Seneva will be a clear favorite, but General June and certainly Great Sister Dane not without a fighting chance. To the main we go at Friday's third. We will sprint 3/4 of a mile, 6 furlongs in this upcoming Florida bred. Here's a bit of a wrinkle. It doesn't feel, Ronnie, like we've run this condition all that often. Certainly in the last 6 months, if not a little longer, about Florida bred restricted $10,000 three and up claimers.
No, you're right about that. I was thinking when I was handicapping this race, I don't ever remember actually handicapping this in the last year or so.
Right.
So I don't know if it's the first or a long time ago, mm-hmm. but an interesting way to set up this race. I did go, and so did you, with the 3. Pango is facing these state bred claimers at 3/4 of a mile. Followed that sprint victory going 6.5, goes back, sets the pace, weakens, finishes third. That's against 16 optional claimers going 1.40 up at Tampa. Juan Arriagada does an excellent job. Victor Lebrun handling the turn back. I think this one fits the conditions perfectly.
I do as well, and you would think this horse, this gelding by Artie Schiller, will be plenty fit coming out of a series of respectable, in context to these, a respectable recent series of races at Tampa Bay Downs, known for its deepness for sure and its depth. A Pango for Ronnie and I as the favorite in the third. Let's move on to the 4th. This one is a multi-tiered maiden 20 on the turf, and I know some people may go, well, look, dude, it's a low-level maiden claimer on the grass. How good of a race can it be? So actually a lot going on within the borders of this eight-horse field as we go the five furlongs. Now, first and foremost, I think, at least as far as me lining up my pre-race bullets, it's that rematch, and you've got nearly half this field today coming out of the same race on April 19th. We'll bring you back to that race. The two horses I think are really worth watching are the one Lucky to Be in America, who's pocketed up, obviously sitting third or a co-third or fourth right now on the rail. The other horse is Elusive Row, who had no position whatsoever, and I thought ran the best race out of the three main players who are returning today. I'm wondering, Ronnie, as I look down at your picks, your opinion of at least Lucky to Be in America on the rail is the same as mine. I thought she had a great trip and really had no serious run. Elusive Row, the one out of this race you want the most.
Yeah, I thought she was a better of the two in that. And now I put the one, as you mentioned, who will be the one today in fourth this afternoon, just because of that performance. But I thought Exclusive Row, who does his best running from that stalk close position, he can sit the garden spot today in there. I did go a little different way, and it was Ron's a Wild, and certainly that was the case with Captain Ron. Now in the Ron Spatz barn, this lightly raced six-year-old debuts locally after showing speed on that downhill course at Santa Anita before the extended layoff. He's a son of Spitestown. Want to show you that on Ronnie Spatz. First after a trainer switch on the turf. Not a big sampling, but okay. 3 for 17, 18%, 35% in the money. 592 is the return investment. And the reason I looked up this stat, I don't remember this ever happening that much, so I wanted to go by, and it has happened 17 times in the past, and you got to go with the Rons, at least I do, and you're getting that hard riding and good riding Jairo Rendon in the saddle.
All right, he's one of the new face layoff drop downs in this race alongside the number four Reorganized. So you've got the two again well connected, including Ronnie Spatz, who's been on a good run of late and is among the top five trainers currently here at the meet in terms of wins, and David Braddy with Reorganized and Captain Ron in that rematch from April 19th. I'm going to give one more chance to the five Free Flame, thinking that, you know what, second off the claim today for co-leading trainer Joe Orsino with that big early speed. If this horse is able to get away from your top pick, Captain Ron, early, shades on, this horse could wire the field.
Yeah, I think the blinkers are really going to help him this afternoon. He was the one afraid that I thought might look Captain Ron in the eye, and that's why Exclusive Row, both of us having second, because that's the one that could end up sitting the trip in this race.
Absolutely. Ralph Nix picking up another win here midway through the Thursday card. You got a number of white-hot barns adding some fuel to the fire, as they say, and a good-looking fourth race cast. As we, in the meantime, take a little time out on Gulfstream today, Stronach 5 and a little Rainbow 6 after the break.
And they're off in the Princess Rudy with a quarter mile left to go. Four off the top of the turn. Race for the Kathleen O'Connell barn in front by five with just an eighth of a mile to go. And she's turning in this into a runaway. The powerhouse performance. She punches her ticket to the Breeders' Cup and wins by five.
PreakTheStakes.com for those tickets to Preakness 144, a terrific multi racing day festival celebrating all things that are great about the game and certainly music and entertainment coming your way at Pimlico in just 7 days, because we are a week out, of course, from Pim Special Day and Black Eyed Susan Day.
Yeah, and if you've never experienced, I know you have when you were in school, to experience the infield and everything when the music's playing, everybody jumping up and down. It's quite a scene. So if you ever get a chance to go to the Preakness, I think you better do it.
Yeah, it's like the Derby if you haven't done it yet. It is definitely a bucket list type event and experience. And for me, not to go off on a tangent, which I'm very good at doing, you remember, 97 and 98, I was going to school in Northern Virginia, and I was a freshman and then a sophomore in college, and caught two good Preakness editions with Silver Charm against Free House and Bob Baffert, of course, and the year after was Real Quiet over Victory Gallop. So at the time, you had two horses both looking, or at least exiting Baltimore with a chance to win the Triple Crown, as Bob Baffert, lo and behold, all this time later, will be looking for that unprecedented eighth win in the second leg of the Triple Crown. We would like, or you know what, I can't speak for you, I would like a win in the Stronach 5. It's been a tough road to hoe, and again, chunky size fields throughout the five-race sequence. That'll, from start to finish, take about 80 minutes as we start things out at about 5:30 p.m. with race number 9 here at Gulfstream Park. And you know, Preakness time is in the air, my friend. Leg B, north of us at Pimlico.
Yeah, Pimlico. And my ticket was $72, as I mentioned. And we started off at Gulfstream Park. And I used the 5, 8, and 11, the 5 Toledo's 10-1 in the morning line. That's actually my long shot this afternoon. And I'll see if I can get that horse home for Terry Pompey. In the second leg, our man Stan up there in Maryland, he singled the number 9 in there. That would be grand. But I used the 4, Nico B. and Keels, I think it is. So 3 and 9 is what I used in there. And then we went to our next stop was Golden Gate, which has been a trick for me. I went with 4 and 10 in there. Party Dancer on the outside from Simon Callahan's barn.
Big and price on that horse,
yeah,
too, right?
I don't think he's going to be that price at all. And then, of course, back to Gulfstream Park, and I went with the 5, 8, and number 9. And lastly, in Santa Anita, 2 and 6 for me. I like Setemar a little bit in there with for Ruiz, the trainer. Well on the turf before.
Yeah, Shelby Ruiz, yeah. She picked up a nice win, I think, Oaks Day at Churchill Downs. I saw that on Twitter. Yeah, she seems to do an excellent job, and she's got a filly by Richard's Kids. Now, as far as my ticket is concerned, I'm going to stand alone with the likely favorite in the first leg. That is the number 11, Early Time, who even with the bum post, trainer change, drop in class, first time Safi, Edgar Zai.
He's the one to beat.
Absolutely.
He's the one to beat.
So I said, you know what? This sequence is really tough, again, when you're dealing with 12s and 12s and a 14. So let me single there and take a little shot for a $36 spread. But I agree with you in looking at least superficially at the Golden Gate race here on the early show. I like your 4, the Irish bred, who's 10-1 with Billy the Kid. That's William Anton Georgie III. And then you've got Juan Hernandez riding for Simon Callahan on Party Dancer. Come on, dude. 8-1 coming up from Southern Cali.
No way is that horse going to be 8-1. I went back and looked a couple of times. I said, boy, I was almost going to single that horse, but I haven't had that much luck. But your ticket, very affordable at $36.
And I'll expound more on the 10th race here at GP. I got a real goofy-looking, big-price, bombs-away-type Joe Orsino, trained second-time starter who's 20-1 on the morning line.
I'd like to hear that.
Oh, yeah. No, the horse looks absolutely ridiculous on paper. Now, let's backtrack, though, or at least come home here, and we'll take our running shoes off, and we'll just exclusively spend the next 6 races at Gulfstream, beginning with the opening leg of what will be a cool 7-figure jackpot Rainbow Six pool that begins in the 5th.
Well, as Acacia says, I'm going to pull the Band-Aid off right away in here with a single in race number 5. Now we had the scratches in there of the 1, 2, 4, and 11. So son of a wahoo, I'm going with this horse, Robert Falcone Jr. I'm just going to take a shot here because I was really perplexed by the rest of the card. You could see in that 9th race, I went 4 deep. The 8th race, I went 4 deep. I just had to find a single somewhere in there. And I got all that coverage just by that. But I got to get son of a wahoo. And I like much, much more with the scratches in that race.
No, I mean, this is a race you'd be remiss, and certainly not. We wouldn't be doing our jobs if we didn't say, I mean, you lost a good chunk of 3 horses that were in the body of the field, and then, of course, the MTO on the outside. So down to a field of 7 after the body was a field of 10. And I had originally liked the 2 Diamond Bachelor. My thinking being that there just was a dearth of clear-cut early speed. With Diamond Bachelor out, I obviously can't have that horse on top, but I do scratch into the number 9, It's a New Year, who ultimately I'm thinking may just almost be the speed by default and can maybe wire the field if I can beat Son of a Wahoo, who is a major player, though.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Now when moving to the Aubrey Mirage Barn after the claim duel throughout as the favorite, finished 4th at this level of distance, now with the scratches and the pace scenario looks very good for this horse, he may steal it on the front end, but I had to go with the 7th Son of a Wahoo. Just been impressed with the job that Robert Falcone Jr. has done. Albert Jimenez, this is a 3-time winner at this mile in the 16th distance. Talking about Son of a Wahoo, I know I'm all over the place, but that was my thought process there.
You're right. And Robert Falcone, who's from New York City, essentially Brooklyn, I believe. He's got the 2-1 basically co-favorite at this point in the first, so might be looking at bookend early pick five wins on this Friday for a good trainer who's made a pretty good mark, no doubt about that. You think Harry Hee will be a slight favorite in the first, by the way?
Yes.
Yes, I'm going to go with Courage and Honor, a slight favorite. I'll bet you a dollar the five's favorite. You're on,
you're
right?
On. All you're
right,
on. Definitely.
Sounds good. Halfway home is we get Ronnie's Rainbow Six ticket and that opening leg out of the way, and as I like to say, we start our run from the half-mile pole with the
see
final five races.
You see how needy is?
Oh, yep, you papers all over the place. Anyway, my late pick five ticket is Merch your best bet today. Yeah. I see that horse in italics there.
No, I did that by mistake, actually, but he's not my best bet. But Merch is, I think, is the one to beat in there. And I used to, you know, we got a scratch of Sky Chaser who
huge.
I had on top.
Yeah,
that's
huge
who I had
scratch.
On top,
me
to be
too.
Honest.
Yep, no doubt about that. The number three Sky Chaser out. I'm 5'7", much like Ronnie, in a race that I think the majority of people playing may just only use the 5 and 7. My single, all my eggs, I mean, literally are in one basket today with the Safi trainer change in the ninth race, the Stronic 5, of course, and in this late pick 5, that is the French bred early time as Safi continues to gain new clients and picking up his first ever horse that I can remember from Attaquette Stables and Michael Dubb. That is a big, big, big inclusion to his operation here at Gulfstream. $18 play for me in the late pick 5, and again, Ronnie, we lost another major player here with the early scratch. A Sky Chaser. You're in the corner of the 5 Mertz. I like the 7 Alpillies. It's probably going to come down to one of these two.
Yeah, Mertz, a 3-year-old daughter of Go Zappa, dropping to the 12.5 level after showing speed in Weakening Lake, was a quartet of sprints at the 25 level. She's a speed play for me, especially at 5.5 furlongs, and especially with one of the speeds gone with Sky Chaser. That was my thought process. But Apillies, I understand, moving to the Jorge Abreu barn via the claim, going back to the main track is going to help.
And Kathy Ritvo with a private buy, in fact, coming back. First time I've seen a horse for this outfit, and I like the stable name, Dog Days Racing with a D-A-Z, and they've got Lil Bubbly, who was purchased privately off trader Kathleen O'Connell. A daylight win, beat Little, but crushed, obviously, at Tampa.
Yeah, 16 maidens, just won it for fun up there, so faces these winners today. We'll see how that horse runs.
All right, let's move on to the seventh race as we head back to the turf course. Field of Eight, in fact, lining up for this $12,500 3-and-up filly mare claimer, and maybe a case, or at least I'm hoping, it sounds good in my mind that Victor Barboza entered two. He has scratched the number 6, Grand Letizia, and he's going it alone with the number 3, Freckles Khan, who's got good recent turf form, that is, with a horse who hasn't run since January. And in fact, here's that win back on January 18. For a filly by Cantharos, Ronnie, who the more I look at her, even though she's won on the dirt, I feel with her big speed, she's just a good fit with these 5/8 races on the turf at Gulfstream.
Yeah, she ran early, and she's perfectly spotted today. When she steps up, she drew clear, as you're watching right now, to beat those two lifetime claimers, as Jason mentioned, was during January. So just was out there cruising on the lead, and we'll show you when this race ends a stat on Victor Barboza Jr. with Freckles Khan. This stat, I think, really adds to the fact that this horse could run well. First start after the layoff, a winner last time out on the turf. He's 5-13, 30%. He's in the money 46% of the time, and a positive ROI of $4.18. With that said, I did go with the number 2, Some Mo Cash, on top of my ticket. And this one now in the Monte Thomas barn. This 3-year-old daughter of Big Drama debuts locally after posting her second consecutive turf victory at the distance and her third win overall when she defeated 16-3 lifetime claimers up at Tampa. I like the recency. The other one not run since January. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't leave it off the ticket. I'm talking about Freckles Khan.
And True Aris in the middle of the pack does come out. Speaking of layoffs, ran 3 days after Freckles Khan did, and in fact, ran 9th, but was running at a higher claiming price and is in for the 12.5, returning for Stiekel Sarris and Edgar Zayas.
Yeah, and that's the key right there. You got the really good turf sprint barn with our leading rider. Is it Edgar leading rider right now? Edgar,
yes, he
the
is.
Leading rider.
And
so,
Miguel Vasquez, not to cut you off, Ronnie, also much like Edgar coming out of a 3-win Thursday.
Yeah, they're doing fantastic, but Edgar on top right now. We'll see how that plays out. It's always fun in the summer. These jockeys keep changing leads.
Yeah, no, and the colony's changed a little bit. I mean, we lost Tyler, and I think many of us expected him to move on, and obviously he rode last fall in Kentucky, but we still have some serious firepower between between Edgard, Misael, and Miguel, and a few other new shooters in the mix. As we move on to our final dirt race on the card, we're on the main here going three quarters with this $25,000 to $20,000 three and up claimer. And I'm going to argue that the three fundies tied, speaking of Edgard Zayas, who should fit this seven-year-old gelding like a glove, considering just how good of a speed rider he is, that Fundy's Tide can hopefully just steal away as the obvious horse to catch. Oftentimes when we show replays on Gulfstream today, it's usually the last out effort, sometimes maybe two back. We're going to go back, though, a little longer than that. In fact, some 51 weeks ago, and I get the relevance of this is obviously open for debate, but Fundy's Tide, I'm hoping, maybe not widening away by 10 at the top of the stretch, may get a very similar trip this afternoon. And in a way, this horse's success, Ronnie, at Gulfstream, it perks me up because I combine the affinity for the main track here at GP with the run the barn's been on. And there really is a lot to like with Fundy's Tide in for the quarter.
Yeah, I had it further down in my ticket just because of the layoff that you mentioned, 51 weeks.
Right,
but when
right.
you saw my Rainbow Six ticket, I added this horse to my ticket for all those reasons. Mm-hmm. Mr. Barn has just been on fire. But I did go with the number two, my friend Flavin on top, who reeled off back-to-back victories here when shipping from the fairgrounds here last year. We'll try and duplicate that feat for Leo Gabriel Jr. after facing Louisiana State Bred Allowance Company in the Crescent City. Comes back, runs exceptionally well here. I'm hoping that happens again for my friend Flavin. And I split him with a drop kick who moved to the Yvonne Belsura Barn. We really like this guy. Let's show you stat on Yvonne. First start after the claim, mid-level claimers on the dirt. He's 5 for 10, 50%, 60% in the money, and $3.85 return investment. So I dialed it down just to mid-level claimers, and boy, the stat was good.
No, good trainer for sure. Sammy Camacho Raj, dropkick, a major player from the inside. I am very much inside three stalls. Ronnie shaking that up a bit, trying to get the five take charge dude in there, perhaps for third, second off the claim for Bobby DeBona. All turf late double begins, as well as the Stronic five. So the ninth race, a busy field, if you will, a three and up Philly and Mare, $35,000 to $25,000 claimers. I've already teased and said why I like the 11 early time, who cannot go through the motions with the post and the field size here of 11, she's going to have to show up. But again, you start going through and checking off boxes of angles that you think might work out well in a race like this. I mean, she's got a lot going for her.
Yeah, she's absolutely one to beat. But I just thought the post, I wanted to have some coverage in there. I mentioned a little earlier that the long shot today was the five Tal Adios. This one is stretching out to a mile and a 16th. Returned from about a three-month layup to finish the wide, but I thought needed fourth against this level of competition. That was going 7.5. Terry Pompey, Jesus Rios named to ride. Early time, the one to beat in there, but I went four deep in my Rainbow Six because I wasn't sold on anybody else in this field.
And I got a goofy bomber for the second spot, the 12 Colonel's Daughter. I love betting off the claim and trainer changes, especially trainer changes with horses that, in my eyes, might be getting a needed change of scenery. And I've liked the work that trainer Juana V has done. And it seems like a pretty crafty, shrewd type of barn, and perhaps they'll get a good effort out of her from that outside post. Wrapping it up, meanwhile, with race number 10, field of 11, as we drop the final call curtain on this May the 10th. We got some 3-and-up Philly and Mare 12-5 claimers.
This
and
I'll is all take yours. It this is all yours.
Well, look, hear me out with the one Awesome Mark. And it, in large part, with me taking a shot with Awesome Mark, not just because of the fact that she's got Joe Orsino calling the shots, which I love right now. I mean, when you go through this race, Ronnie, I mean, you pick the first-time starter, which to me is almost an indictment. And right. I get your thinking. I mean, I've got your horse second.
Right.
There is really no reliable turf form or any consistently good turf form in this 11-horse field cast. I mean, you look at a horse like the 7 Reconsiderate, who I think will run well. Horse is 4-1 on the morning line and winless in 24 starts. Point is, this could be a good spot for a fuzzy. I get the leading trainer at the meet, second-time starter who was just run off her feet at nearly 99-1 first time out. She's had some time since that race. Out of a dam that won five times on the turf. I'll get a good jockey here. don't get, if you're playing around with some tries and stuff, give this one awesome mark a bit of a look.
I want to show you, I went from check to X to question mark when I did
that. Well, good, I'm glad in the end, you know, you hit all the emotions there, but in the end, you kind of left her as maybe a gray area type filly who might make some noise here.
Yeah, definitely, and you make a great point for that, because as you mentioned, I did go with a first-time starter with Prickly Kitten, who's the daughter of Kitten's Joy, debuting for Mike Maker, so I'm playing a percentages deal, the ideal spot for a first-time starter, leading rider Edgard Zayas. That was what my thought process was with that.
No, if that firster in context can run, there's a good chance could be very tough to cut down there in the final few strides as we are just getting underway from the starting gate. Ronnie and I with you all day downstairs from our paddock set studio. Pete Aiello up next with those scratches and changes.